Hi everyone, it's Heather Darnall. Welcome back to my art channel. Thank you for joining me for another video. Today's painting is on the unusual side for me because when I paint something, you know, I see something that inspires me and then I kind of want to make it my own. Or I'm just kind of in an experimental phase and just want to have fun. But either way, this is going to be fun because, hello, it's painting and art and I'm all about just using the gift that God gave me. But this specific painting, I also want to emphasize, wasn't something that I saw and just kind of made my own. This painting was 100% inspired by the Holy Spirit, as in every little detail to it. He said, you are going to paint this. That said, this is more of a prophetic type painting. Now, I'm not saying I'm some sort of prophet, like in the Old Testament times where God would, you know, set apart specific people and tell them to say and do things. Prophecy really has a wide range of definition where, you know, two people could just be sharing scripture, or one person could just be sharing something that was placed on their heart by the Holy Spirit. It really just does have a number of different meanings, which also comes within the art form, because God can use people and he does use people to speak to other people, rather verbally or on a canvas or whatever talent or skill that he has gifted them to utilize. So that's why I feel this painting is super unusual, but I'm so happy that he gave me an image because it finally gave me this settling feeling. And this unsettling feeling I had was, I was basically just surrounded by, for a period of time, people that as an outsider looking into their heart, I would imagine they are not saved. And I say that because of their words and actions. I can't really tell what their thoughts are because I am not psychic, I am not God, but thoughts usually start from the heart, which ends up coming out as words, which then go to actions. And these words and actions were not reflecting God in any way, therefore leading me to believe that they're just straight up fools. And I'm not saying that to be mean, I am just saying that in a way because it's evident their heart is not with Jesus. And if it's not with Jesus, they're basically a fool. And when you're a fool, when you act a fool, you do and say certain things, especially when they're very opposite of what God would say and or do, because Jesus came to show us to say and do specific things because they reflect him, and that's what he wants us to do. He wants us to reflect him, that way more people know about him and how he lived and how he wants us to live. So anyways, this image given to me was very, it's basic, because, you know, there's not a whole lot of complicated aspects to the overall composition. And therefore, that's a good thing, because anybody that's not really inclined to the Bible or hasn't really read a lot of it, it's simple enough for them to see and pick up what I'm putting down as far as the meaning of it. Something that they might understand, so when they look at it, they can identify where they stand currently in their faith. Are they on a path to eternal life, walking in righteousness, or are they on a path of death, walking towards, you know, suffering in eternity in hell? So that said, I'm going to share with you some scripture for our ministry snack that comes from the book of Ezekiel. Again, I'm going to take sections out of it because for the sake of time and just sharing what is most impactful. But this painting really is to, what I'm saying now is to remind people of, you know, how we tend to be when we are not saved. We are foolish. We're foolish. What else can I say? And that just means that we do a lot of dumb things. Being unwise and arrogant and prideful, all this kind of stuff falls under the umbrella of being foolish. But because I have black and white in there, I want to make it very, very clear that this is not a painting or an image that is showing, you know, the enemy to be an opposite of God, because that does not exist. So this scripture is clarifying that in the book of Ezekiel, chapters 26, verses 2 through 4, 27, 1 to 9, and then 28, chapters 28, verses 1 through 18. And it reads, "Son of man, because Tyre has said concerning Jerusalem, 'Aha, the gate of the peoples is broken. It has swung open to me. I shall be replenished now that she is laid waste.' Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Tyre, and will bring up many nations against you as the sea brings up its waves. take note they were a city in the midst of the waters. They shall destroy the walls of Tyre and break down her towers, and I will scrape her soil from her and make her a bare rock. Now, real quick, I just want to explain this bit here so it doesn't seem or feel so random, just in case I fail to mention later in my breakdown. But Tyre was not only a city that dwelled in the midst of the seas, so you can think of like Hawaii or something like that, just out there in the water, but it was a major international merchant port, a place of which many nations relied on many goods and supplies, most heavily within the Mediterranean area, but also stretched further out to more distant nations. And because of the beauty of the city, its riches and abundances, is why the prince saw himself as a god, particularly a god in the heart of the seas, thinking that he was solely responsible for all of its success and beauty, also looking at himself to be just as beautiful as the city he dwelt in. And so now Ezekiel is going to prophesy about how his city was built up, made like a fine ship since the city is in the midst of the seas, but also built up with the fine materials, which are the items mentioned, but they're really only mentioned as a comparison, you know, like materials, to hammer home the point of just how luxurious the city of Tyre was made. Only now God is telling Ezekiel to cry out for their sakes because it will be wiped away. The word of the Lord came to me, now you, son of man, speaking of Ezekiel, raise a lamentation over Tyre, which is the people and the prince, and say to Tyre, who dwells at the entrances to the sea, merchant of the peoples to many coastlands, thus says the Lord God, O Tyre, you have said, I am perfect in beauty. Your borders are in the heart of the seas. Your builders made perfect your beauty. They made all your planks of fir trees from Sinir. They took a cedar from Lebanon to make a mast for you. Of oaks of Bashan, they made your oars. They made your deck of pines from the coast of Cyprus, inlaid with ivory. A fine embroidered linen from Egypt was your sail, serving as your banner. Blue and purple from the coast of Elisha was your awning. The inhabitants of Sidon and Arvad were your rowers. Your skilled men, O Tyre, were in you. They were your pilots. The elders of Jabal and her skilled men were in you, caulking your seams. All the ships of the sea with their mariners were in you to barter for your wearers. So now Ezekiel is calling out the prince of Tyre on the behalf of the Lord, as it states in chapter 28, the word of the Lord came to me, son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, thus says the Lord God, because your heart is proud and you have said, I am a god, I sit in the seat of the gods in the heart of the seas, yet you are but a man and no god. Though you make your heart like the heart of a god, you are indeed wiser than Daniel. No secret is hidden from you. By your wisdom and your understanding, you have made wealth for yourself and have gathered gold and silver into your treasuries. By your great wisdom in your trade, you have increased your wealth, and your heart has become proud in your wealth. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you make your heart like the heart of a god, therefore, behold, I will bring foreigners upon you, the most ruthless of the nations, and they shall draw their swords against the beauty of your wisdom and defile your splendor. They shall thrust you down into the pit, and you shall die the death of the slain in the heart of the seas. Will you still say, I am a god in the presence of those who kill you, though you are but a man and no god in the hands of those that will slay you? You shall die the death of the uncircumcised by the hand of the foreigners, for I have spoken, declares the Lord God. And here Ezekiel is continuing to say on the Lord's behalf how he is comparing Tyre to the enemy and how he was made. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, sardius, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, and jasper, sapphire, emerald, and carbuncle, and crafted in gold were your settings and your engravings. On the day that you created, they were prepared. You were an anointed guardian cherub. I placed you. You were on the holy mountain of God. In the midst of the stones of fire you walked. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created till unrighteousness was found in you. In the abundance of your trade, you were filled with violence in your midst, and you sinned. So I cast you as a profane thing from the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O guardian cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Your heart was proud because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom from the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I exposed you before kings to feast their eyes on you. By the multitude of your iniquities and the unrighteousness of your trade, you profaned your sanctuary, so I brought fire out from your midst. It consumed you, and I turned you to ashes on the earth in the sight of all who saw you. All right, so Ezekiel was an Old Testament prophet, but before I get into the scripture portion of this, I just wanted to help you better understand or have a better idea who Ezekiel was and this bit of history that I'm going to share with you, so it all makes better sense if you didn't already know. And also to warn you up front that this message will be rather intense, so brace yourselves. Now, this was the time just before King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon was about to march on in and utterly destroy Jerusalem, as into bits and pieces, to just complete rubble, to put it plainly. Now, here's a little fun fact. The prophet Jeremiah was also tasked to share God's word around the same time, also giving them warnings so the people would hopefully clean up their acts so that they wouldn't have to face any of these horrible consequences. Otherwise, really bad things were going to happen, and I mean really bad. Now, if the terms to utterly destroy, to make waste, or make desolate were used, which they were a multitude of times, should give you a hint just how bad things were going to go down and how serious the Lord was that he was just done putting up with their junk, you know, which also included the allowing of the slaughtering of people, even livestock. I mean, how much more to the point can one get? You know what I mean? Which simply just because they refused to have God in their lives, which also means they had no interest in having any of his protection either. To paint a better picture of why God would allow all this slaughtering to go on and desolation is to basically think that he drew a line of tolerance and had some grace, noticing as people were just struggling, just having a bad time, and decided, you know what, I'll erase that line and I'll make another one further back. And again, notice them struggling, and by his grace again, erase that line and drew another one further back, and so on, until he was just noticing, you people aren't even trying anymore. Look at all these lines I've drawn because I love you. I want to give you all these chances, but now you're just straight up rebellious, and I've had it. I'm done. And we've all been done before. We've all had it with something at some point. And that was him at this time. And just think here, we are here today still. We are still around by his grace. But I imagine he too has been drawing plenty of lines for us. And, you know, who's to say when he will be fed up? So this kindness and grace that he has been showing his people, including us, isn't to be mistaking his kindness for weakness. Rather, it's just a chance for us to repent, you know, turn away from our loosey-goosey sinful ways and get right with Christ already. Now put yourselves in God's shoes. He simply honored their request with a heavy heart, because he will always honor whatever choice or request that we have, because he gave us free will. And then we wonder why our lives are so trying and difficult, because we want nothing to do with God. The God that says, take my hand because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Funny how we want the complete opposite, which just doesn't make sense. This was a time where many people were also going to be carried away into captivity. So if Nebuchadnezzar didn't already wipe it off the map or put someone to death, then he was going to literally haul it off back to Babylon, because that was also part of the punishment, and because he could, because he was the most powerful king, which included people, livestock, goods, anything with a physical existence, down to the little things that we would think are insignificant. Ezekiel also had a lot of prophecies concerning the second coming of Jesus. So he came the first time when he came to save the world, not condemn it. And he been there, done that, and he's going to come again, hence the second coming, only this time he's not going to save it because he's already been there, done that. He is going to judge it. And that is what is going to be called the Great Tribulation, which is also referred to as the end of days or end times. Here is a fun fact. It's kind of neat too. The prophet Daniel, who was also carried off into captivity into Babylon with Ezekiel, also had very vivid images of the Great Tribulation, which in my opinion, I would think if you read them too, they're pretty disturbing. I mean, they're really freaky. But if you're saved, thank the Heavenly Father that you won't be around for any of that stuff, because it just blows my mind why people don't open the Bible and see what is coming in exact detail, how it's all going to go down. The only thing no one doesn't know is just the hour when it's going to happen. So if you're not saved or prepared, my advice is to no longer procrastinate. So now that Jerusalem has been dealt with, the Prince of Tyre was basically rejoicing over the fact that Jerusalem had been made to bits and pieces, to complete rubble, just utterly destroyed. And so because he was rejoicing, God's reaction to that was like, oh, okay, so that's your reaction. Well, my reaction and my promise to you is you're next. You guys, God gets extremely upset when people rejoice over other people's dealings. I mean, that is nobody's business other than the person who was getting the dealings and with God. So it's a mano y mano, A, B situation, and we should see our way out of it. You know what I mean? Totally corny, but you get the point, right? And so God, because that happened, because they were rejoicing, the people and the prince were rejoicing over the destruction of Jerusalem, he basically judged them in the same manner. And that goes for us too. So reflect back on the Gospel of Matthew, where he says in chapter 7, verse 1 through 2, judge not that you be not judged, for with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Is that not clear? That you, hence we, need to clean up our act, or else, maybe the same thing is coming our way too. That said, the Prince of Tyre had it coming big time, which Ezekiel had prophesied about. But what do you know? That fool, Prince of Tyre, didn't listen. And that goes for so many of us today, people. We simply refuse to listen to the warnings and or soak in the warning signs of what's to come. So now God is dealing with the Prince of Tyre, and guess what he does next? He compares him to none other than Satan. The worst of the worst of the worst of the worst, you guys. And this is why I feel like this part of scripture really helps define the fact that Satan is not an opposite of God. He has an opposite agenda. And that could be very easily mixed up and or misunderstood. I mean, I thought earlier back in my non-saved days that he was basically a deity of some kind with all of his powers, not realizing that Satan is a creation, which is very different than being a creator. So God prompts Ezekiel to tell the Prince of Tyre. He's like, you tell that cat, because his heart was so proud or prideful, which is something I've mentioned many times and will continue to talk about in the future, because it's that important. Basically saying that you're a god and you're sitting in the seat of gods in the heart of the seas, but you're really just a man. You're just this little peon. You're not a god whatsoever, though you think otherwise. And oh, by the way, you have the audacity to think that you're wiser than my prophet Daniel. You are off your rocker, dude. I'm gonna turn you into the ashes and all the earth in sight of all who saw you. So as I've said before, there is no such thing as sinning in secret, not even our thoughts, because God is all knowing, which is why he has no problem and enjoys, in a weird way, throwing himself out in front of that oncoming train, so to speak, guarding us and protecting us from the foolish thoughts and actions we have, you know, that we want to carry out, but we ultimately and sadly and carelessly just push him out of the way, instead welcoming that train wreck ourselves. So God continuously is recapping all the words that the Prince of Tyre is going on and on and on about himself, and then basically tells him in detail how it's all going to go down, and not just go down as in be brought down to your knees and then die by the sword, but as in he's going down all the way to hell. Please don't forget, people, that going to hell is a choice that we make. God just doesn't want us to make that choice. Hence the reason he's constantly throwing himself out in front of us to protect us, to help us repent, to change, to help us draw closer to him so that we don't have to suffer eternally. God also says in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 33, verse 11, he says, as I live, declares the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Well, if he has no pleasure in the death of the wicked, why would we have any pleasure in the death of the wicked or people that just make bad choices? You know what I mean? I guess it's okay to feel a sense of relief, you know, when our threats, you know, have been deceased or decreased to some point. You know what I mean? But we really should be grieving for the fact that these people are where they are, being a place that is unimaginably horrible. You know, and because it's so horrible, we can't even imagine how bad, just like how heaven is so wonderful, we can't even imagine, humanly imagine how wonderful it is. But really the point is they should have just and could have just followed God's 10 commandments, you know, and then having done that, lived it up in, you know, heaven for eternity, rejoicing forever as we could and should too. Which is also why we need to pray for those who make bad choices, even our enemies, including our leaders, you guys. Because in my opinion, I just personally feel, I'll be frank about it, they're just leading us into the wrong direction. But the bottom line is to also consider the fact that when we have a ruler that makes bad choices, it's very likely that the people are going to follow, kind of like how we are in a situation in modern times today with our leaders. But anyways, so the people of Tyre, their hearts were really no different than the prince, which is why he, you know, destroyed that place too. Because had they had been a follower of God and honored him, then he would have protected the people and just dealt with the prince. So wiping somebody else out because someone else was wrong doesn't line up with God's loving nature. That's why the whole, that's why all of Tyre suffered, just like all of Jerusalem and Judah and all that, all those places suffered tremendously, because you're either on his side or you're not. They were not, especially the prince. Anyways, he tells Ezekiel to take up a lamentation and cry out over the prince of Tyre and tell him that I made him perfectly beautiful, full of wisdom, precious like a stone, just like how I made Lucifer, who was an anointed guardian cherub, which is singular for an anointed angel, whereas cherubim is plural for anointed angels. So in other words, they were both made with higher authority, found blameless from the day that he was created and set above other angels. But then, like Lucifer, God had also found unrighteousness in the heart of the prince of Tyre. So the prince and Lucifer were made to be set apart or set above, just like any other ruler from all the way back then to current times, you know, only they also had the same prideful junk in common. And they also had in common the same destiny, which is hellbound, also known as Sheol or Gehenna. Also, like Lucifer, violence had filled the king's heart and they sinned. They were both super prideful because they were beautiful, and not just internally, but externally too, you know. And because of all the awe they had received in their beauty and their wisdom, which made them to believe they were all that in a bag of chips, you know. And we see that in so many people too today. People, you know, living to love and obsess over themselves, as did Lucifer and the Prince of Tyre. Thinking how Right Said Fred sings in his ridiculous 1992 song, you know, where he's like, I'm too sexy for my shirt, you know, too sexy for your party, too sexy for my hat and my car. I mean, he's just too sexy, you know. The point is made. So as you can see, we just love to go on about ourselves, and social media has been a major platform to keep that pride going strong. And you guys, let me just say too that I was also super prideful like that at a time before. I mean, we all struggle with it, even the saved. So all that said, God comparing the Prince of Tyre to Satan, formerly known as Lucifer, should be a key indication that Satan is not a deity. He is not a god, and he never was. God has always self-existed. He is the beginning and the end. Only with him, there really is no end, which is like weird to say it like that then. But anyways, the book of Revelation chapter 22 verse 13 clarifies that, as it says, or Jesus says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. So before I close the next few minutes, just keep in mind that Satan simply opposes God. He is not an opposite. Oh, I agree with a pastor that I heard saying that when we say he's the opposite, it's basically giving him a title, you know, being an opposite. But God stands alone. He is infinite and eternal. Again, Satan was created. He is not the creator, only he creates evil on all levels. You know, he is the prince of the earth, the father of lies, the great deceiver, just to name a few. That said, God didn't create Lucifer to be what he is now. That was Lucifer's choice, and he just had a really bad outcome. Now, if you look at the other two anointed angels noted in the Bible, which there's only two mentioned by name, being Michael and Gabriel, then I can see Lucifer would be an opposite to them, but not to God. We just so happen to give Satan power when we distance ourselves from God and or reject his protection, which would make it seem like that he is God's opposite. But God has no equal. He has no rivals. He has no competition. He has nothing that stands in his way. We just let Satan stand in our way, therefore making us believe that he's got to be standing in God's way too. But God is in control. What feels like the enemy is doing to win all these battles in life are actually serving God in a way that we may not understand, or we may not ever understand, at least while we're on earth. And when we get to heaven, we won't even care anyways, you know what I mean? But more importantly, keep in mind that the enemy's power is currently restricted. When we go or pass on to our spiritual eternal life, I really do believe that God is going to allow us to see Satan as the elephant in the room, so to speak, you know, giving us the opportunity to physically lay eyes on him, just allowing us to stare at him, as the prophet Isaiah says that God told him in chapter 14, verse 16, when he's referring to Satan as when he says, "But you are brought down to Sheol, to the far stretches of the pit. Those who see you will stare at you and ponder over you, saying, 'Is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms, who made the world like a desert and overthrew cities, and who did not let prisoners go home?'" So yeah, I really do believe that we're going to have a firsthand look at our enemy and be like, "Oh my gosh, is this the dirt bag, to put it as cleanly as possible, that literally gave us hell on earth?" You know what I mean? Oh well, sucks to be you. Bye, Felicia. So I'm just going to put it out there, truth and all, that it is unfortunate but very sad that anyone who is not saved, unfortunately, they are a fool. They are still unwise, wicked and evil, prideful and arrogant, judgmental and hypocritical, just to name a few. But even if they seem nice, they are still a fool, because God knows the heart, and the heart is what is so deceiving to people. I mean, we were fools too before we were saved. So what can we expect from a fool who's not saved, even if they're a nice fool? Now, I'm not saying that anybody who is saved still doesn't struggle with these iniquities and types of sins, but anyone saved was saved because they asked for forgiveness and continue to ask for forgiveness, having vowed to do their best as humanly possible to live for God in all the ways that glorify him and have the intentions to always walk in his righteousness. That means having a forgiving heart, showing, you know, mercy and grace, being kind and patient, even when it's the hardest thing to do. And trust me, I'm the first to say that is super hard for me to do, but even especially it's hard to do to or with our enemies, because that's what Christ did for us. That's right, he nailed our iniquities on the cross with him. You know, "Oh, you did that? No problem. Nailed that. That's done. Oh, you did that too? Oh, that's right. No problem. That's done too." So just to prove his love and promises to us, don't forget the Apostle Paul wrote in the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 8, as it says, "While we were sinners, Christ died for us." Now take note that while Christ died for us, the enemy wants us to die without Christ. Talk about a black and white image and concept. All right, guys, let's get started. Today, I'm going to use a 12 by 16 cradled wood panel, triple primed with gesso. I'm going to start by adding some Windsor blue, then some light blue permanent. Then next, I'm going to add some cerulean blue hue, then some turquoise blue. Next, I really love this color. It's an iridescent fairy tale blue. And then followed by an iridescent playful blue, which looks white and it is, but the light gives a soft blue tint to it. Now, I really do have a lot of colors going on here, probably too much paint too. But I really do love all these shades for my living watercolors. I think collectively they make a great water or oceany colors. So here I'm taking a piece of damp paper towel and just gently swiping it across or over the paint to combine my colors. And I love how I can already see some cell action popping up, but they won't be there for long because I actually want to use a small palette knife to create some semicircle details. So hopefully I get some even after further swiping, but first I'm going to push my paint to the line that I drew in. Now what I'm looking for is for both sides to be semicircles, so that when it's done, the circles, like the semicircles, come together and they look like they join together or close enough. Okay, I'm liking what I see, but I lost my Windsor blue and my playful blue. I need more contrast and highlights, so I'm gonna add a little bit more back in and see what I get.
now I'm just torching any air bubbles and to see if I can get any more cells, which I don't see. And I don't think I made any improvements, unfortunately, with the Windsor blue and Playful blue. So now I think I'm just going to run my knife edge around a bit and see if maybe anything underneath comes up. Okay, on to the wilderness side. I'm starting with warm gray, then some unbleached titanium, followed by an iridescent gentle sunrise. And then I thought, why not add this Naples yellow hue that I had left over from another pour, you know, just use it up, pour some of it. Finally, a deep pearl brown for some contrast, but I think I might have gone a little too heavy on that one. Now I'm just repeating the process using a piece of a damp paper towel to swipe and blend my colors. Yeah, that deep pearl brown is muddying my colors, but I think I'm going to keep going anyways. Maybe the palette knife will bring up more of the lighter colors from underneath. Now, if you're a note taker, be sure to write this down. Try to remember to wipe your knife between each swipe to help prevent mudding, which I so didn't do that. And as far as my paper towel goes, I really should have just used that for one swipe, meaning use one end to swipe once, then use the other end to swipe once, and then just toss it and get a whole new one. So it's funny, I'm doing what I don't recommend. I mean, well, it might be okay for a couple of swipes, but to continually swipe without wiping could definitely be the reason why your color's muddy like mine did. All right, I think I'm gonna go off camera and fix this muddy mess, but at least you have the concept to what I'm trying to achieve so far. And then you'll see me pick up and continue when this part is dried. All right, so it's all dried and I was able to fix my base colors. So now I have two 5x5 hearts that I drew and cut out and placed the ends in the center for my guidelines. So now I'm gonna pour some pyrrole red and some cadmium yellow deep hue around one heart and then take my straw and blow to create flames. As you can see, I do several layers, really just trying to achieve the look of flames, and a lot of them too. You'll notice I left out orange because I'm hoping that the red combined with the yellow will give me orange, and so far it's working, but it's more of a deep orange. Now I'm just going to torch out any air bubbles. Here I thought I'd experiment a little, so now I'm using a flat shader brush to see if I can make the edging look like flames too. Okay, I'm going to be honest here. I'm rather disappointed because now it's too much. That experiment was not a good idea, so I'm going to tackle that later and move on to the other heart. for the other heart, I'm pouring crimson red for the blood of Jesus Christ instead of more pyro red. I think that color is just too bright. Blood is actually rather dark, and so I want it to be as close as possible. Here I'm tilting it so that it will give a dripping look, but it's not giving me that outcome. So now I'm going to roll up a paper towel and just push some of that paint back up and then try again. Hopefully that'll do the trick. Okay, perfect. That's working. So now I'm just going to add an extra bit on the sides and call it good. All right, so my flames and blood have dried, so now I'm gonna fill in my hearts. For my heart, the desire of sin, I'm using Mars Black, which dries with a little bit of redness to it, followed by an iridescent fancy black for some detail. Okay, check this out. I'm actually using fondant tools for cake here that I got at Michael's, and this one has an angle, which I'm using to gently push the paint to the outline of my heart that I drew in earlier. I want to use another ball tip fondant tool to run through my paint, and there wasn't enough, so I added a little more. Notice I tried to keep the shape of the heart as I was running my tool through the paint. Now for my heart that has been washed clean by the blood of Jesus, I'm using some titanium white followed by an iridescent white for added detail. You'll see I use the same fondant tools to push my paint and to run through my paint. I know it's hard to see the black on black and white on white, but hopefully you'll be able to see later how the lighting picks that up. Now I'm going to create a deceptive path of righteousness that goes from the edge or the corner of the panel to the bottom of the heart that burns for and desires sin, just right along the dividing line of the living water side and the wilderness side. I'm just using a flat brush for that, but I'm using titanium white as the base color because it's opaque and will cover the dividing lines pretty easily, followed by more iridescent white on top. Next, I'm just going to add a couple of drops of titanium white at the base of that heart so that I could gently drag in the white into the black and the black into the white so that there's more of a transition rather than just harsh dividing lines. For the other side, I'm going to create another path in the same fashion that represents our life walking in sin or walking in darkness before we are washed clean and saved by the blood of Jesus, using Mars Black as the base followed by an iridescent graphite on top. Okay, so now I'm going to add a few drops of Mars Black at the base of that heart to repeat the transitioning look into this heart as well. Okay, now that my hearts are dried, I'm going to take a medium round brush and border my heart of sin and darkness with the color bronze, which represents his righteous judgment. For my heart that has been washed clean of my sin, now living in his light, I'm using the same brush but bordering it with the color gold, which represents kingship, glory, and holiness. Real quick here, I'm going to go back to the sinful heart again to paint in a demonic symbol to further or better identify the meaning of this heart, and then paint in a cross on the other heart. Here I'm using some painter's tape to help me make a straight line that represents no heartbeat, as it represents a fatal path walking and living in deception, while the other side I'm adding in the symbol of a heartbeat that represents eternal life once we have repented and received our gift of salvation by the blood of Jesus Christ. Here's more quarter-inch painter's tape that I have put down so that I can use this space to write in various scripture that would act as the border details. What I have in mind is to include scripture that points out or calls out the foolish, the unwise, the deceived, along with those who deny the Holy Trinity on the half or side of walking around aimlessly like fools in the wilderness who love their sin and darkness, hence the black paint marker. Now for the opposite side of having repented, being surrounded by his peace, walking toward his light where we are then washed clean and forgiven by the blood of Jesus, loving and worshiping our King of Kings, I am including scripture that points out or calls out those who desire his wisdom, receive his wisdom, reminding the wise to walk in righteousness in his light because he is the light, as well as being deemed forgiven, protected, guided, and blessed, hence the white paint marker. By the way, I'll include all of the scripture in the description for you in case you'd like a closer look and or to look up and keep as reminders for yourself. Boy, I love that. Such a unique way to add border detailing, especially because I just couldn't make up my mind which scripture to use. And trust me when I say that's a drop in the bucket. But anyways, now I'm going to do an experiment. Here I'm painting a phosphorescent paint that glows in the dark along the path leading to salvation and the heart of holiness and purity. So here it is, all finished and covered in some epoxy resin, where you'll also hopefully see all those iridescent colors coming through. Wow, just looking at it amazes me how God puts things on your heart, like to literally paint hearts, which tells all because he knows all, especially our hearts. So now let's see it laying flat as a whole to get an overall view and appreciation for not just the painting, but the message within the visual of this painting. Well, I'm glad I gave you a close-up because it's more difficult to see the metallics and iridescent colors here, but it's still good to have one more glance, especially because it's time to reveal the moment of truth about the hidden feature I added, which is the phosphorescent paint. And as always, another truth emphasized that the darkness will never overcome the light because he is the light. He is our waymaker, miracle worker, light in the darkness. unstoppable and unchallengeable on all levels, worthy of all the praise. Now, before I sign up, I just wanted to remind you that all my paints and supplies are listed in the description, and I also wanted to say the artist's creed with you, so that whatever you do that God has put on your heart, you do it with His strength and confidence, as it reads, I believe my talents are a gift from God, and I am to use them to fulfill His purposes in my life and in His world. I humbly acknowledge and accept my gifts as I ask to receive God's vision for how I am to use them. I ask the Holy Spirit to free me from self-doubt and self-absorption. I pray this work will bring me into closer alignment with God's plan for me as I seek to bring my gifts and talents into His light and to become the whole and complete person He intends me to be. Amen. Now that concludes this demo. Thank you so much for allowing me to share with you what God has put on my heart and for your willingness to listen to His word. So if you like this, please be sure to not only share it, but to also hit like and subscribe for more videos. Your support really helps me out and also continues to share the most important factor of all, which is God's word. Alrighty guys, don't forget to thank God for this opportunity and to always paint from the soul. See you next time.